Our first speaker tonight is the British Army's top man, the Chief of the Defence Staff. Importantly for this evening's discussion, he previously served as commander of ISAF, NATO's International Stabilisation and Assistance Force in Afghanistan. Last year, calling for more troops, he warned that defeat for NATO there would have an intoxicating effect on militants around the globe. If Al-Qaeda and the Taliban believe they have defeated us, what next, he said, would they stop at Afghanistan? Ladies and gentlemen, General Sir David Richards.
Well, thank you, Richard, and good evening to everyone. It's excellent to be here in such august company, and thank you for inviting me. The reason I accepted, of course, like any true cricket-loving Brit, is that I've always wanted to meet that particular cricket legend. So, Imran, you're the reason I'm here tonight. It was a bit of a no-brainer. But, no, more seriously, I'm also devoted to trying to help improve things in Pakistan and the Near East region generally. So I was genuinely delighted to be able to take part tonight, and given the experts here, undoubtedly in my case, to gain more than I can hope to contribute. Now, James Ferguson, in his excellent book on Afghanistan called A Million Bullets, quoted me as saying something to him that I would just like to repeat as we sit here in the warmth of this room with the luxury of hindsight and little relative responsibility. I said, "We're here, we are where we are today, and I did not have the luxury of wishing things were different, however tempting and interesting. I'm sure you accept this, but especially given the inadequacies and failings of our fellow man, it is much harder to be an active practitioner than to be an analyst, historian, academic, journalist, etc., especially when they have the benefit of hindsight and no pressure of time and events, i.e. to do rather than to criticise others who have to do." Now, whilst accepting many lessons can and should be learned from what has happened in the past, I would recommend that we focus tonight on Pakistan as she is and seek solutions on that basis rather than spend the evening criticising others for what she has become. Another reason I say this is because the international community has been terribly good at coming up with bright ideas and clever solutions to the problems besetting nations like Pakistan. They have been woefully poor at implementing those ideas in a timely and efficient manner. One reason, other than an inability to focus on implementation mechanisms, is too many give way to the temptation to live in a pretend world rather than the harsh and difficult reality of, in this case, Pakistan as she is today. I want to try and keep my remarks in the real world. Secondly, let me make clear that I am a serving soldier who does not want to get drawn into some of the more political issues that lie at the heart of the region's troubles. I will, on occasion, therefore, perhaps reserve the right not to comment. Having said that, I do recognise, as one must to find any kind of way through them, the internal and regional complexities and politics that lie at the heart, or the core, really, of Pakistan's problems. I, like I'm sure all of you here, wish her and the countries of the region well and want to help. One key requirement to have any effect, I have learned, is to see each country's situation from the perspective of that country and not from a Western one. This may seem self-evident, and I bet most of you are nodding in agreement, but I promise you, despite it being so central to the search for workable solutions, it rarely seems to happen. A word on the often maligned Pakistani army, which I know well. Objectively, and I hope you'll agree that I'm somewhat qualified to judge, the Pakistani army is doing very well indeed. After a visit to the country in the autumn, so impressed was I by much of their operation in the Swat Valley, that I asked General Kayani to send an officer to our staff college to explain what they'd done and to enable us to learn from them. and he has done this, and I have to say the visit of that officer was a great success. Critics underestimate the huge military challenges the Pakistan Army faces, geographically, logistically, technologically, and of course sometimes with the political environment in which it has to operate. On top of that, obviously, it faces determined, cunning and ruthless enemies. It is a mature army that remains cautiously well-balanced, determined quite rightly to protect its metaphorical and physical flanks and rear, as we might say in the army. It cannot do everything instantly that all would like of it, and the army is right not to try or it will become very vulnerable, something we should all be most wary of provoking. It is a vital pillar, whether one likes it or not, in the Pakistani state and its relative stability. The civilian casualties in Pakistan have been up to 400 a month, and the army's fight against a domestic enemy has been vital to the people of the country and securing their support. One shouldn't underestimate the role played by the civilian government, with all the criticism one can make of it in some respects, in ensuring that the people remain firm in this vital struggle, despite the terror attacks on so many of them. A word on Pakistan more broadly. I visited there a number of times and usually through some limited type of sightseeing or shopping trips try to gauge in my own inadequate way the public mood. As is the case in neighbouring Pakistan, and this is borne out by all the relevant polls, as good as they can be, 90% of the population simply want the freedom and security to live their lives undisturbed, able slowly to improve their lot in life. They do not want to live under an extreme TTP Islamic government, and they prize security, followed by jobs, more highly than anything else. Are we, ask yourselves, are we and our families any different? Of course not. And in this respect, we should expect nothing else. We need to remember this as some blithely talk about surrender or leaving the region to sort itself out. And embittered people who have been promised much and then let down hugely may just exact their revenge in due course. More widely, beyond Pakistan, the states of the region need to understand better the risks in allowing, perhaps sometimes contributing, albeit unwittingly, to an unstable and potentially failing Pakistan. They, like us, need to work constructively and generously, generous-heartedly too, to stabilise a country whose people deserve our support. India's role in this respect is vital. I know many place huge faith in that great country to assist its Muslim neighbour, with whom they have so much in common and with whom its future will be even brighter. In order to help them, help each other and Pakistan, I'm an advocate of the need to establish formal top-level mechanisms for discussion and decision. We got very close to creating what we call the Joint Afghan-Pakistan Action Group, or JPAG, in 2006. The aim was to bring the ministerial level of the Pakistan and Afghan governments together regularly and mechanistically, probably with an international facilitator, but co-chaired at presidential level, to discuss issues about which a consensus exists, but no action occurs, for want of any mechanism to provoke it. From small beginnings and dialogue, that's my one-minute warning, growing understanding of common ground and mutual interests, I think, will develop, and the more difficult issues then may in turn be slowly addressed. The unexciting business of process is, from my experience, often more important than many of the clever ideas. Finally, the price of a failed or collapsing Pakistan, geostrategically as well as regionally, as Richard said in his introduction to me, I think would be huge indeed. Arguably, Pakistan holds the key to stability, not just in the Near East, but potentially right across the Muslim world, and the opposite is equally true. And I look forward now to listening to what my fellow panellists have to say and to taking part in the debate. Thank you very much.